We start with our module 1, start with the definition, the well-ordering principle. If A is a set of positive integers, then A contains a smallest integer. That is, A be a set containing positive integers, then well-ordering principle says that then the set A must contain the least element or the smallest element. So move on to next definition, that is divisibility. We say D divides N and we write D divides N whenever N is equal to C. That is, if N is an integer which is a multiple of D, then we can say that D divides N. And this is the notation. And we also say that if N is a multiple of D, or D is a factor of N, or D is a divisor of N. If D does not divide N, then we write D. This is the notation, D does not divide N. So the condition for D divides N is N must be a multiple of D. Okay. Then move on to our first theorem, theorem 1.1. Divisibility has the following properties. First one, N divides N, that is every integer divides itself, that is reflexive property. Second one, D divides N and N divides M implies D divides M, that is transitive property. Third one, D divides N, D divides M implies D divides the combination AN plus BM. That is linearity property. Fourth one, D divides N implies AD divides AN. That is multiplication property. Next one, AD divides AN, and if AN not equal to zero, then we can say that D divides N. Okay. That is cancellation law, that we can cancel A from both sides. The only condition is A must be non-zero. Next one, 1 divides N, that is 1 divides every integer. And N divides 0. Every integer divides 0. Then 0 divides N only if N equal to 0. And D divides N and N not equal to 0 means absolute value of D must be less than or equal to absolute value of N. That is comparison property. This is the important one. Next, D divides N and N divides D implies absolute value of D equal to absolute value of N. It's not say that D equal to N because we can say that 2 divides negative 2 and negative 2 divides 2. So we can say that the absolute value of the two integers are equal. And last one, D divides N and D not equal to 0 implies N by D divides N. Okay, these are the divisibility properties. Next, to move on to a definition. If D divides two integers A and B, then D is called the common divisor of A and B. If D divides A and D divides B, then we can say that D is the common divisor for A and B. So next theorem 1.2, given any two integer A and B, there is a common divisor A of A and B of the form D equal to AX plus BY. That is, if D divides A and D divides B, then D is of the form AX plus BY, where X and Y are integer. Moreover, every common divisor of A and B divides D. Any other common divisor of A and B divides D if D is of the form AX plus BY. So our proof is start with case 1. That is, we assume A greater than or equal to 0 and B greater than or equal to 0. That is, both the integers are non-negative. So we use induction on n equal to a plus b. So first case, if n equal to 0, then we can say that a plus b equal to 0. That is, a equal to 0 and b equal to 0, because a and b are both positive, greater than or equal to 0. They are not negative, so both the integers must be 0. So in that case, we can take d is equal to 0. That is, D is a combination of AX plus BY. So for N equal to 0, the result holds. So D equal to AX plus BY. Now we assume the result holds for 0, 1, 2, etc. N minus 1. And we consider the integer N. And without loss of generality, we assume A is greater than or equal to B. And if B equal to 0, we can see N equal to A, and we can take D equal to A, that is X equal to 1. D equal to A, X equal to 1, therefore we will get D equal to AX plus BY, because B equal to 0. Therefore, d can be written in the form ax plus by. So in that case, the result holds. So we assume b is non-zero, and that is a greater than or equal to b and b not equal to 0. So we consider the integers a minus b and b. And we have a minus b plus b is nothing but a, which is equal to n minus b, which is strictly less than n minus 1 by the condition of a and b. And then by the induction hypothesis, we can say that there is a common divisor d of the form d equal to a minus b x plus by. For every integer less than n, the result holds by induction hypothesis. Therefore, in that case, we can say that there must be exist a common divisor of the form a minus b x plus by. So here the two integers are a minus b and b. So d is of the form a minus b into x plus by, that is nothing but ax minus bx plus by. By rearranging, we can say that which is equal to ax plus b into y minus x. So here x, y are integer, therefore y minus x is also integer, that is d is of the form ax plus b into an integer y minus x. So using induction hypothesis, the result holds for every. Now we prove that every common divisor of a and b divides d. So we assume that e is a common divisor of a and b. That is, e divides a and e divides b. Then linearity property. Using linearity property, we can say that e divides ax plus by. Okay, you can check the condition. Linearity property, third condition. If d divides n and d divides m, then d must divide the combination an plus bm. So here e is a common divisor of a and b, therefore e divides a and e divides b. That implies e divides the combination ax plus by, that is e divides d. And the second case is we assume that a less than 0 and b less than 0, because first case we assume a and b are both non-negative integer. Then we consider the case when both the integers are negative. So in that case, we consider the absolute value. So we have absolute value of an element must be greater than or equal to 0 always. So if a less than 0 and b less than 0, we consider the absolute value. The absolute value of a greater than or equal to 0 and absolute value of b is greater than or equal to 0. So we can use the condition one, case one, and using that we can say that the result holds here also. Hence the proof. Move on to next theorem. Given integers a and b, there is one and only one d with the following properties. D greater than or equal to 0, d is non-negative, always greater than or equal to 0, and d divides a and d divides b. If e divides a and e divides b, then e must divide d. Okay, there is no proof for this theorem, and move on to next definition. The number d of the theorem 1.3 is called the greatest common divisor of a and b, that is GCD, and is denoted by open bracket AB. This is the notation for GCD. Or we can say that ADB, that means d is the greatest common divisor of a and b. So the properties of common divisor is it must be greater than or equal to 0. If d divides a, the greatest common divisor must divide the integer a and b. And if there is another common divisor e, then e must divide d. That means d is the largest common divisor, greatest common divisor. If a and b, GCD of a and b is 1, then we can say that the both integers are relatively prime. There is no common factors for a and b. The largest common factor for a and b is 1. Therefore, we can say that both the integers are relatively prime. Move to next theorem. GCD have the following properties. First one, GCD of AB is equal to GCD of BA. This is directly holds from the definition. Second one, GCD of A and GCD of BC equal to GCD of AB and C.
Third one, GCD of ACBC is equal to absolute of value of C into GCD of AB. Fourth one, GCD of A1 equal to GCD of 1A equal to 1. This is directly holds, and the GCD of A0 equal to GCD of 0 is equal to absolute value of A, which this is also directly holds. So here we have to prove second and third property, that is GCD of A and GCD of BC equal to GCD of AB and C. So we take D equal to GCD of A and GCD of BC, and E equal to GCD of AB and C. And we choose GCD of BC equal to D dash and GCD of AB equal to E dash. Therefore, we can write D is equal to GCD of A and D dash, E is equal to GCD of E dash and C. To prove both the GCDs are equal, we will prove that D divides C and E divides D. Okay. We have to prove this condition, then we can say that D is equal to E. So first we prove D divides, we have D is equal to GCD of A and D dash. Therefore, by using condition for GCD, we can say that D divides A and D divides D dash. That is, D divides A and D divides D dash. That is, D divides A and D divides D dash is nothing but GCD of BC. That is, D divides A and D divides, from this condition we can say that D divides B and D divides C. So we combine first two conditions, that is D divides A and D divides B, means D divides GCD of AB by using the property of GCD, and D divides C. So here GCD of AB is nothing but E dash, that is D divides E dash and D divides C. Again, we combining these two condition. If D divides two integers, then D must divide their GCD also. That is, D divides GCD of E dash and C. That is nothing but E. Therefore, D divides C. D divides C. The same way we can say that D divides D. We start with the definition for E. E is nothing but GCD of AB. GCD of AB and C. So we can say that E divides GCD of AB and E divides C. Again, E divides GCD of AB means E divides A and E divides B and E divides C. So we combine second two conditions, that is E divides A, and combining these two conditions we can say that E divides GCD of BC, that is D divides A, sorry, E divides A and E divides GCD of BC is nothing but E divides E dash, sorry, D dash. Again, combining these two, we can say that E divides GCD of A and D dash. That is, E divides D. So, first we get D divides C, and here we get E divides D. From these two conditions, we can say that E is equal to D. That is, GCD of A and GCD of BC is equal to GCD of AB and C. So, move on to proof of third condition, that is GCD of AC BC is equal to absolute value of C into GCD of AB. So we take E is equal to GCD of AC and BC, and D equal to GCD of AB. So here we have to prove that E is equal to absolute value of C into D. Now we start with the D. Since D equal to GCD of AB, there exist integers x and y such that D equal to x plus dy. This is by the condition for D, by using the condition of D. D is of the form a combination of A and B, therefore D is equal to AX plus BY. Now, E is equal to GCD of AC and BC, that is E divides AC and E divides BC. That is, E divides the combination also, that is, E divides ACX plus BCY. That is, E divides, we can take C outside, ax plus by. That implies e divides c into ax plus by is nothing but d. That is a divides cd. Then by using comparison property, we can say that absolute value of e is less than or equal to absolute value of c into d. That is e less than or equal to absolute value of c into d. Now we will prove the converse case. We have d equal to gcd of ab. So we can say that d divides c and d divides b. That implies dc divides ac and dc divides bc by divisibility property. That is dc divide the combination also, or sorry, ac and bc means dc divide gcd of ac and bc. That is dc divide gcd of ac and bc is nothing but e. That is absolute value of dc is less than or equal to absolute value of e. Or we can say that d into absolute value of c is less than or equal to e. Then by two condition we can say that e is equal to absolute value of c into d. That is e is equal to absolute value of c into d. That is gcd of ac bc is nothing but absolute value of c into gcd of ab. And 4 and 5 directly holds. So hope you understood. See you next time. Thank you.